Well, folks, Antonio T. Smith Jr. is doing it again.
He's done it again.
Yes, he has. Giving away so much knowledge just to help you succeed. Walk out of the middle class. Become a multimillionaire. He is giving away his book just for you.
The name of that book? The Richest Man in the Trash Can. You want to make sure you get this book. Here's why.
If you are someone who is tired, frustrated, irritated of the day-to-day schedule of waking up, going to work, going back home, going to sleep just to do it all over again, not being able to spend time with your family, you just got married, you just had kids, or you take care of your parents and you're not there to do it, this is the book for you.
And guess what, ladies and gentlemen? This book is free 99. Yes, you heard me. Free 99. Okay? All yours that. For free.
Yes. Free 99. All you have to do is just pay shipping and handling.
That's it.
$9.95 just to get your free book. This book is a life changer. I'm trying to tell you guys, everything in this book is what Antonio taught myself and Grace that enabled us to retire. Yes, we are retired and we haven't even hit our 40s yet.
Woo!
I'm just saying.
I got a few months to go. Don't worry about it.
Shh. Don't nobody need to know that, girl. You don't look it.
That's it.
Go get it. Go get it and walk yourself out of the middle class into the life you deserve. Walk yourself into abundance. Abundance is freedom, and this book is your journey out.
You can plant better.
You can dominate.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the best class of all time. Someone has been mentioning best class of all time this evening, the Integrity Leadership class. I'm about to get out of the way of greatness because I am not your trainer, but we have two well-able and well-capable trainers this evening. They are Miss D. Marie, Deanna Mitchell, and Mr., come see about me, Reginald Paul.
Hello, everyone.
Hello, good evening, good evening. Excited to get started this evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for joining myself and Mr. Reginald Paul for the Integrity Leadership class. We are starting in peaks and valleys. So who all has been able to get your book and read chapters 1-3 so far? So we got two people who have their hands up. If you don't have your camera on, please feel free to use the little blue hand to let us know who has purchased your book and who has read chapters 1-3. Thank you, Ms. Shannon. Ms. Shannon posted the audio book in the Zoom chat. I need a head count. I need to know who has read and who has not read. All right, guys. This is going to be an interactive class, so I need you to work with me here. So who has not? Okay, Miss Michelle G, I remember. Miss Adanya, okay. Maurice, were you raising your hand? Awesome. Okay, so we have three people that have read. We have a few that have not. I just want to get a head count of what we're doing.
Hey, I've been skipping through the book. I didn't read the first chapter, but I started at like 25 and then the last chapter.
Okay. All right. So we're going to get started then. Peaks and Valleys is the story of a young man who lives unhappily in a valley until he meets an old man who lives on a peak and it changes his work and life forever. This is for those who have not read. Initially, the young man does not realize he is talking with one of the most peaceful and successful people in the world. However, through a series of conversations and experiences that occur up on peaks and down in valleys, the young man comes to make some startling discoveries. Eventually, he comes to understand how he can use the old man's remarkable principles and practical tools in good and bad times and becomes more calm and successful himself. Now you can take a similar journey through the story and use what you find to your advantage in your own work and life. So what Mr. Reginald, Paul, and I are going to do is we are going to pick out some of the things that stood out to us, and we want you to have an open discussion with us on what that means to you and how you can apply it to your life. So Mr. Reginald, Paul, if you want to get us started.
Well, off top, what I've picked up out of it is I picked one word, and it's called character. Point blank period. I chose character because people say that you're born a leader, you're not born a leader. You find out who you really are when you're around other people. You find out who you are when you're by yourself. But I chose the word character just because I wanna start a topic about knowing your character and who you are. So if anybody wanna start off by explain to us what you think character means.
All right, so this is where you unmute your mics and explain to us what you think character means. All right, Ms. Maya?
I guess character would mean just who you are.
Okay, so, and Grace, if you can put these in the chat for us, that would be so awesome. Miss Michelle G, I see your hand is up. Go ahead.
I would say not just who you are, but also the type of person that you are. It would be your level of integrity, your level of I just lost your level of integrity, your demeanor, all of that would be a part of it. Your personality, everything.
Okay, and then James says, who you are when no one else is looking, what you stand for, and weight of heart. So who else wants to let us know? Well, who else can tell us what they believe character is? Okay, Maurice?
Individual to characteristics of who you are. Individual characteristics of who you are. As we said that, you know, honesty is telling the truth, integrity is living the truth. So, but your individual characteristics of who you are as a person, your personality, that's what it means to me.
Those are good examples. Now I want to put a little twist on it. I want to add, can somebody build your character? Can somebody make your character? If you are who you are, could you let somebody else build your character? Or could you let somebody else create a character? Two different questions.
All right, so we're gonna have Phil, I saw you unmuted your mic. So Phil, we have you first, and then Miss Michelle G, we have you after Phil.
Well, I think my definition of character will answer both questions. It's the values that you choose to live your life by. So you can let somebody else choose your values, or you can choose your values.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Phil. And Ms. Michelle G, you're next.
I would say only you can make your character. You can allow someone to influence your character, but they can't make your character. Only you can do that.
All right, does anyone else want to answer the question?
What was the question again?
Could somebody build your character, or somebody create a character? in you, yourself?
I believe someone can build a character, because I had no character before playing sports, and I had a coach who saw something in me that I didn't see in myself. Not until after becoming a champion, I realized I was a champion. So that's him building it, pulling it out. And then as far as the second part is, when you let someone not make, but influence or pour into you, you have to allow the credible person to pour into you versus someone that's not credible pouring into you, and that could make or break you.
All right. Thank you so much, James, for that. That's a good point. So Reginald, if you don't mind, if we can expound on that, like, what do you mean? If someone can break that down to us, what he just said.
Like, elaborate more? Oh, sorry.
Well, you use a sports type of demonstration. So, yes, a coach can be your character, but you already, before you got on the court, you was already a character, for one. Before you stepped in anywhere, before you did anything, you was already a character. You got to figure out what type of character you are. It's going to be confusing for a little bit, because you're going to have somebody else, and I'm talking from a sports point of view. It's going to be funny for a coach to tell you who you are when you should know who you are already. Even if you step on the court and you're not good enough, you think, or I can't do this, you think. First and foremost, before stepping on the court, you should already know that you're on the court for a reason. So a coach can add value to you, but once you go out there in them trenches, you'll find out who you are.
Can I ask a question of?
Yes.
Who's about character or a character? So is it, the character, are we doing both? One is a character and one is character?
Well, what I meant was creating a character. Gotcha. Somebody else, like the coach, creating a character in you when you already stepped in as a character.
Okay.
Okay, and does everybody get what Reginald just said? Because if Maurice has a question, that means someone else has the same question. So did everybody get what Reginald just said?
I think I have a question too, so I don't know that I'm getting it.
Okay, go ahead.
Because if we're saying that a person can build your character, wouldn't that be saying the same thing as a person can change you?
That's fair.
I mean, because realistically, nobody can change a person. That person can only change themselves. They can influence you to change, but they can't actually change you. So am I understanding correctly, or?
Yes, ma'am. Exactly.
Thank you very much, Miss Michelle, for breaking that down. So that way, because again, if you have, just like Maurice had the question, you had the question, someone else had the question. So thank you for talking that out with us, so that way everyone else can understand as well. And Reginald Charmont had a question. She said, is that the same as character development?
Well, the next segment I was getting to was character building. That's what I was leading up to with these questions, is character building, how to build a character. For one, like I said, me walking into a situation, and this is me, I use I statements, me walking into a situation, I wouldn't want nobody to, unless I need it, I wouldn't want nobody to build a character for me. Unless constructive criticism is involved. because I'm already a character. Now, if my character don't fit that platform, then whoever's in charge of that platform has all rights to build my character for that platform.
All right. So who has questions about what Reginald just asked? And Ms. Adanya, I do see your hand up.
Hi, I'm sorry, I'm just walking in the door, but this is a powerful conversation, because here's what we don't want to do. We don't want to make any of us wrong, but at the end of the day, we all have opinions. And here's mine. No one could force or make someone change. No one. The only person that can change you is you. It's an inside job. You're the only one. Someone can influence you. They can threaten you. They can cheer you on. They can motivate you. But at the end of the day, the end result of change is you taking an action, period. Not someone doing it for you. That's my opinion. I know that's very strong, and it doesn't mean I'm right, but that's my belief. And I hope that it sits well with you guys. I'm not trying to make you believe what I believe, but I think it might even be something that can be proven. You cannot have someone else change for you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Adanya. So with what Ms. Adanya just said, because she said you cannot have anyone change for you, Reginald just said you are already, he's already a character, which means you are already a character. So when it comes to your character building, how do you do that without feeling like someone's changing you? How do you go through that character development or that character building without it seeming as though you are not being yourself? If I'm asking that question correctly, Reginald.
I mean, with that platform, again, it depends on what door you walking into. If it also depends if you want somebody to build your character, that's fine. If you want to build your own character, that's fine. Either way, because we have some on that side of the fence and some on the other side of the fence. I just wanted to know other people's opinion on character. Should we let someone build our character, or should you go on and be your own character? I was just interested.
All right. And with that, Reggie, we have two hands up. Miss Michelle G, you're first, and then Miss.
Keep the hands coming. Stay alive. Keep the hands coming.
Yes, please.
Feel free to let it out. Don't hold it in. And when you get out the conversation, I should have said this. No, you can say it right now. Feel free. We got 40. Well, time is no such thing. So feel free.
Okay. So first we have Miss Michelle G, and then we have Anthony.
Okay, with that and with your question, Deanna, I would say this. You would be who you choose to be. You would take the parts that person is trying to give you, that constructive criticism, you would pick out the parts that you choose to change, and you'll change. You'll make those changes accordingly. But if it's something that you disagree with or you don't want to do, you're not going to do it no matter what. But it's all about that individual person and if they really want to change to the situation. And it doesn't matter what the situation is. If they want to take the influence and use it and change according to what that influence is telling them, then they're going to do that themselves. That influence is just that. It's that influence.
All right. Thank you, Ms. Michelle. That leads me to another question, because you hit on something. You said when someone wants to change, and they will, at what point do you decide that, okay, you know what, this does not work for me, I'm ready to change? And before we answer that question, Well, go ahead, Miss Michelle.
I was just going to say, honestly and truly, some people go their entire lives and never change. But it just, it's all about that that person's mentality, their maturity, and what they want for themselves. If they don't want anything, if that mentality's not there, they're immature, then that's what they're going to remain to be. But if you want more, you want better, your mentality is better, you have matured, then that's saying you know better, you do better. That takes effect. And it's that individual person, because again, and to this day, I know some my age and older who have not changed. In their late 40s, early 50s, they have not changed. And so it's that person.
All right. Thank you, Ms. Michelle. You definitely touched on some things. It is the person. You know, you have to make the decision that this does not work for me, or that does not work for me. I don't like what happens when this happens. So what in me is causing this, so I can decide for myself to change this particular part of my character? All right. So, and we have hands everywhere, Reginald. So let's see what we have. So Anthony, you're next. After Anthony, we have Maurice, then Shannon, then Miss Adanya. So Anthony, the floor is yours.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. Two parts. Good First evening. Of all, my opinion is everyone is saying the same thing. It's like a formula boiling in a pot, because this is no one word answer. This is multiple things that adds up to your character. And what I wanted to say is, first of all, and I know it's been said before, you got to know what you want. And sometimes what you want is going to contradict how you living. And you got to be consistent on, just like someone said, like, if you know what you want, then that's what you're going out of. You're going to do some things in order to get what you want. That's really not true, but it is you, because that's who you're trying to develop yourself to be. It's not who you are right now, but it's who you chose to be in the future. And like I said, that's going to contradict some things that you're doing, but obviously you have something on your mind to think that something is not right here. This something is just not working here. I've been doing the same thing, but I'm ending up in the same place. So I obviously have to change something. And to change something with our flesh is so used to doing the way we want to do things that it's going to tell you, you know, this is not you. You know, you're being phony. This is not you, whatever. But you got to know what you want and go after it and be consistent. And the second part, I would say, it's kind of two-part answer, but you never want to build your character up. Because if you build my character up, I got to live up to what you said I was or who you think I am. Exactly. But when I get there, I'm going to be who I am regardless. So you may try to do me a favor, try to build me up, but you told him something that I ain't. And if I'm going to be myself, I don't want to be phony. But then again, like I said, it depends on how you look at it. Jesus Christ was John the Baptist told him there was one coming. He built his character up, but he lived up to everything and above what he said he was. What if he wasn't able to perform miracles and do all this that John the Baptist said he was going to do? He would have heard him instead of doing him a favor. So it all depends on how you look at it. But the most important thing is know what you want, go after of it, and regardless of what everyone else say, because you're the one going to have to deal with it in the end.
Wow. Thank you, Anthony. Thank you very much. You said something that also sparked a question, because you said, if you want something, go for it. But at some point, what you want is going to require a character change. So at that point, you're going to have to decide if you want to continue to go for what you focus for your focus, or if you just want to stay where you are. And like Ms. Michelle was saying earlier, some people just don't want to change. So what I get from that is your focus. What you're focused on will force you to decide if, okay, I want to make this character change because what I'm focused on requires this particular change in me, or you know what, I don't feel like doing that, so I'm gonna stay where I'm at. So thank you, Michelle. Thank you, Anthony. Now we're going to move on to Mr. Maurice, and then after Mr. Maurice, we have Shannon, Adanya, Cameron, and Charmone. So, Mr. Maurice, the floor is yours.
Now, I'm going to be short because I think everybody several people touched on the point I was going to make, and it's redundant. That character, really, I'm responsible, or the individual is responsible for their own character and being changed. And it's okay to take and borrow from someone to help build your character in a positive way. If there's positivity there, I think it's okay to borrow from someone to help strengthen your character. But at the end of the day, that responsibility lies on the individual. So it really lies on the individual and the individual themselves. But that's all I have.
Yep. No, thank you, Maurice, because you in the little you said a lot. You say you can borrow from someone else. What's the point of getting a mentor if you don't need someone else to pour into you to help you build your character? Again, you get to that point where it's like, okay, what I'm focused on, which is what Anthony said, what I'm focused on, I'm gonna go after it. But at some point, your character is going to bump because your character is not in a position to get further. So when it comes to what Reginald was saying earlier, do you let someone help you change your character? That's when that comes in. It's like, okay, let me go get a coach to help me because there's something I'm trying to get to, but I'm not quite there yet, and I need some help with that. And then it still goes back to what Michelle said earlier. Some people just don't want to change. So thank you. The little that you did say, Maurice, was a lot. So thank you. Thank you still for speaking up and saying what you said. Now we have Dr. Shannon R. Clark. The floor is now yours.
Good evening, everyone. Character is always an intense subject. And what we have to realize is nobody develops their character by themselves. You don't do that alone. When you were born, your parents or whoever raised you contributed to that. If character is personality and demeanor and who you are, you didn't have control over that when you were born. And so when you get older, you have to seek wisdom in order. You're not going to build your character by yourself. The character that I have now, Antonio can put his signature on it. Jesus can put his signature on it. My parents can put their signature on it. It's whoever I allow to influence. But you need people to develop your character. When you use a term like build, it takes people to build. It takes multiple hands to build. And so can somebody come up to me and say, you need to be more humble? Yes, they can. Can I reject it? Of course. Can I refuse to change? Of course. But if I agree and if I say, yes, I do need to be more humble, my next question is, what do I need to do? And if we look into the book, that's what the main character did. He didn't get help, however, with his character from where he was. He had to go to where he wanted to be. And when he got to where he wanted to be, he leaned into somebody that could help him be the person that could last there. So you definitely need people. Send me a person that says, I am who I am because I did it all by myself.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Shannon R. Clark. So that leads me to ask the question to everyone. How do you know when you have chosen the right person to pour into you? So we're gonna put a pin in that question, and we're gonna do, because Shannon said a lot. Shannon said a lot, and it tied into what Maurice said. It also tied into what Michelle said and what Anthony said. And it all started off with Reginald's, Reginald's title is all about character. So let's go ahead, Miss Adanya, the floor is now yours.
Really? You gonna make me come behind her?
Man, really? Look, I'm sorry.
Miss Shannon, really?
Why you think I had to stay alone?
Okay. But
This is such a topic that I have passion on, so I'm going to be very careful not to talk too much, because I can, this will just, it excites me and makes me crazy. But I have two really quick points. First point is kind of vibing off of what Michelle said. There are people, correct, that do not want to change. There are people who do not know they need to change. And there are people who believe they want to change but don't know how. There's various levels. Change is introspective, but it's also perspective. It's different for everybody. The other point that I think that kind of supports that is the only reason, and my belief is the way a person changes, they cannot think the same. It's a mindset shift. You cannot be a different person. You cannot do something different, better, or what have you, without thinking different, because your thinking got you where you are to begin with. So it requires a shift in thought process. Yes, people will influence that. Yes, people can help you change, but it's a shift. Last statement, a coach can't change anything for you. That is not our role as coaches. A coach's job is to influence you to find your needs, find your reason, find your how, and help you figure out you need to change and come up with your own solutions. 99% of us know the answers. We have them. Their coach's job is to pull it out of you. The coach's job is not to tell you what to do. That's not our role.
All right. Yes. So, and it, again, so that it, thank you, Ms. Adanya, because you said a lot. The last thing you said, though, is not a coach's job to change you. It's your coach's job to pull out of you what's already in you. So again, and this is, when I ask this question, I want everyone to just write this question down and really think about it. How do you know you have chosen the right person to coach you, mentor you, whatever it is? How do you know that you've chosen the right person? And Ms. Adanya just hit on it. A coach doesn't tell you what to do. They pull out of you what's already in you. So now we're going to move. So thank you again, Ms. Adanya. Now we're going to move over to Cameron. Cameron, the floor is now yours.
Thank you so much. I'll speak briefly about character, and that, yes, we have influences growing up. There does come a point in time where we then become responsible for our own character. I would also say, to form one's character, we have to begin to lose those things that do not shape our character. There's a commercial, you know, that encourages, a local radio station does a commercial that encourages people to get out and about, and they begin to discover things about themselves that they never knew, that's always been there. Well, they lost, you know, a bunch of hair or they, whatever, but they, in losing that, they begin to discover their character. So, like, what are we willing to give up to form our character? Are we willing to give up those negative thoughts? Are we willing to give up those friends that do not build us up? And what are we willing to give up about ourselves? And, you know, someone spoke about, you know, the humility. And you'll learn sometimes really quick that our arrogance gets in the way. So I would speak to that in terms of how our character gets formed or shaped, and what are we willing to give up to allow that character to be formed.
Thank you, Cameron. Thank you very much, because you touched on one of the things that Shannon was saying when she was talking about him. you have to, you do have to give up something. You have to give up the part of you that wants to, let's say you're looking to lose weight. A part of you, there's a part of you that's always wanting to, you have the, it's a habit. It's now a part of you. You have to go into, okay, I want to lose weight, but every time I feel a certain weight, I can't go grab some ice cream out of the freezer. So what are you going to give up? Are you going to give up the ice cream in the freezer, or are you going to give up your focus of losing weight? And it all still boils right back down to, do you choose? What do you choose? Do you choose to grow, or do you choose to stay where you are? You know, and Shannon said, humility is a gigantic part of it, and gratitude. And then Ms. Adani just said, you know you're with the right coach when you begin changing in a favorable manner that you approve. Because again, it all falls down to you. So thank you, Cameron. Thank you, Shannon. Thank you, everyone who has spoken previously. And now we are going to move over to Miss Charmone, Corey, and then Maurice. And then after that, we're going to shift it back over to Mr. Reginald. So Charmone, the floor is now yours.
Oh man, I think I forgot what I was going to say listening to everyone else. But I always thought that everyone was born with character. So as you get older and you start to develop, your core person isn't what's changed. It's those immature parts of you that gets changed. And then when you aspire to get to different levels, you either attract those people that you need to change those immature parts of you, or you find people that's where you want to be or have what you want to have as far as, I guess, character traits or behaviors, and surround yourself with those people and start to develop the behaviors and that they have to change those immature parts of yourself. And in doing that, you're not really changing who you are. You're just developing into a more mature person. So that's how I always saw it.
Thank you, Ms. Charmone, because you shed a different light as well. You bring in the factor of maturity. You know, maturity is allowing for certain parts of your character to release or let go of or lose certain parts of your character in order for you to grow, to get to your focus. So thank you very much, Ms. Charmone. Thank you very much. Now, Mr. Corey Peters, and then Maurice, and then we're going to shift it back over to Mr. Reginald. Oh, Corey, we can't hear you. Hey, Corey, can you hear us? We can't hear you. Oh, we still can't hear you. Okay. So let's see, while we're working on the technical difficulties on that end, we'll, Maurice, the floor is now yours.
Okay, just as I was listening to what everyone else said, and looking up the definition of a coach, and a coach is one who gives advice, he gives direction, he trains, he's a private tutor, and as a coach, and if he's doing all those things, that means that he's going to have to know something about the individual that he's training. And the individual that he's training is going to have to be humble enough and be sacrificed enough to give up something. First, he came to the individual because he's being coached, or she's being coached because I identified there's something that I need help with. And that means I have to surrender and be humble and give of myself, you know, give myself of that portion of myself that I have accepted. First, I acknowledged it, and I've gone into agreement with the fact that there's something that I do not know that someone else knows better than I do. So I'm going to allow that person, I have to give of myself and surrender that portion of myself over to that individual. And how I know that I've have the right person, what was it, the trainer or the right person to help build my character, is the best that I can think of is if there's darkness. And how do you know that you have an electrician is if you got the electrician and the lights come back on. So if I begin to get better and I begin to manifest those things that I sought after when I'm working with the coach or the person that's helping me to build my character, then I know that I'm in the right place and getting, you know, that I have the right. So there should be some measurable results that I should be able to see at some point that I'm with the right person. And I should be able to feel it and see it in tangible results, you know, see it and it should be measurable. I should feel it, know it. It should be spiritually fit. It should spiritually be fit. And you should be able to physically see it. That's what I would say. Thanks.
No, thank you very much, Maurice. Thank you very much. And that boils back to what Shannon posted in the chat. She said, I just lost. Humility is a gigantic part of it. And please forgive me because someone else said that earlier as well. You have to be humble enough and have enough humility to say, hey, I need help. And I am going to not be arrogant and receive all of this information that you're about to guide me through, coach me through, direct me through, teach me. Everything that Mauricia said a coach was, you have to have enough humility to forget everything you already know. And then you also have to not be arrogant to think you know everything that you can't be taught anything else. And then Corey Peters. He wasn't able to speak to us, but he posted, he said, character starts with a choice of who you want to be in the moment. And that being shows up from the future that you are living into. Once you are aware of who you want to be, you can align yourself with people and situations that would support that way of being. And then Ms. Michelle said, accountability and intuition. So it all boils down to humility, what you're willing to let go of and release. And all in all, do you want to change to reach your focus? Do you want to change to reach your focus? All right, Mr. Reginald, the floor is back to you.
All right. Good job, by the way, Dan. Good job. Every ingredient in this big pot of gumbo. First and foremost, I'm going to be me, and I'm going to always be me. Where was y'all at when I was in high school with all these tips and this information? Because they would have helped me become a better person I was, because I wouldn't listen to none of that stuff they were trying to tell me anyway. But what I just heard tonight, that was well needed. And I want to say thank you to each and every last one of y'all that participated and added value to not only yourselves, but to everybody that's here in this platform. By the way, this is my first time ever on a platform like this. I usually like speaking to you in your face, eye to eye, nose to nose. That way we can see each other's spirit and feed off that. But I'm feeling the energy from everybody, and I appreciate it once again. Now, the two main ingredients that I've heard that really stuck with me in my gut was humility and sacrifice. I'm going to say it again, humility and sacrifice. Now, that reminds me of a carpenter that we all know about, humility and sacrifice. And basically, that was his character. He was humiliated, we all know, and he was the sacrifice. And in order to live, you have to sacrifice. That's what life is. Life is a sacrifice. So with all that being said, with all this good energy, I want to throw a little twist in it and talk about the name of the book, Peaks and Valleys. Now, with this character, what type of, let me see if I can get this out right. Now, if you are in the, let's say you're at the valley, would you like somebody to build your character while you're in the valley, or build your character while you're at your peak? Do I have anybody that want to tackle that one? I'll say it again. If you are in the valley, would you want somebody to build your character then? Or if you was in a peak, would you want somebody to build your character then? The floor is open. Anybody?
Okay, so Dr. Clark said both.
I'll say on that part. If someone else is going, I'll wait.
Okay, so we'll do it this way. Dr. Clark, James, then Michelle G, and then Cameron, because I see your mic muted, Cameron. So Shannon, Michelle, Shannon, James, Michelle, Cameron. There we go.
So I did answer both, and unlike Reggie, who's doing a very, very good job, I would have to be completely honest with you all. Most of you probably know this is not my first go around with this class. And so with me saying both, I'm just putting that out there as both. I'm gonna let back up and let everybody else kind of flesh it out, because I've read the book like four times. And so my answer both comes from this class and reading this book several times. So I'm not even gonna open it, blossom that flower any more than I already have. And I'm gonna sit back and listen to all these brilliant minds let this flower bloom.
All right, Dr. Clark, well, with that being said, James, you are up.
So the way I take it is like, you have to have a capacity. It's like a cup, and the cup is empty. And you fill the cup up with your character and your personality, your spiritual side. As you fill that cup, you couldn't do things at the peak if you're not even prepared for the peak when you're in the valley. When you're in the valley, you have to take the time to sacrifice and go through humility. So when you're at the peak, no one can, you know, you'll have the capacity to take on people telling you yes or no, telling you no, telling you this, you know, you think you're too good for everyone. And it's not that you're too good for everyone when you had to work for it, and you know what it's like when you have nothing. You know what it's like to have nothing, so when you get everything, it's appreciated. The capacity part is when you are in the valley. Let me say this too real quick, real important. Actually, I thought we were talking about another book. Antonio's book. So I haven't read anything from this book, but thank you, Miss Clark, for the link, because that's the first thing I'm going to do when we get out of class.
And thank you for your transparency.
With that being said, when you're at the valley, you move slow. You do the true fundamentals down in the valley. So when you get to the peak, you can climb fast. You can move faster. When you climb a mountain, as you rise in the elevation, the air gets thinner. It's harder to breathe. But when you're on the bottom, you got all this air, but it's hot. And that's another, it's like you take away one thing that you're complaining about, or you take away one of the things that's causing you to suffer, which causes a sacrifice, and you take it away, you'll get something else in return. But that same thing in return will be the same thing that you only get it because you sacrificed for it. You only can handle that air up there because you were trained at the bottom for it. So it's almost like the valley trains you for the peak. When you get to the peak, you can appreciate the valley.
All right, James. So you had, when you said, the valley prepares you for the peak.
So it sound like he read the book.
Right?
A piece of the page, at least.
I'm in the trenches right now. I'm in my own trenches. And I don't even, like, all the time I say, like, man, why I gotta do this? Well, I got to do that. Like God always tells me, he makes it known that, hey man, if you can't do this, how you going to do that? If you can't get through this, you definitely can't get through that. So you need to like learn how to manage the small things. So when I put you in front of the big things, you can keep your composure, not lose, not freeze up, and things like that, of that nature.
All right. So thank you, James. I want to present something to you real quick. If the valley prepares you for the peak, how long do you think you need to stay in the valley to be prepared for the peak? Wow. That's a question for you. That's a question for you. That's a question for you. But thank you, because like Reggie said, it sounded like you did read, you know, a paragraph on a page in the book. So congratulations, because no, you really, you whether you read the book or not, you still added value. And that's all that matters, is adding value. And ladies and gentlemen, like Reginald said, he's going to be himself. So you be yourself. This is a safe place. It's a reason why it's called the Integrity Leadership Class. This is where you can grow with us. As you read this book, you'll notice there's things in this book, and it makes you question things. When those questions come up, ask them. If you have something on your heart to say, say it. This is a safe place. There is no judgment here, because when Antonio and Tempest developed this course, they understood that there's going to be some things that are going to be tough for people to face alone. And that's why we're here. We are now a family to work it out with each other. So please don't be transparent. Be transparent. That's the only way you are going to grow from this. It's the only way you're going to grow from this. So next we have Miss Michelle Cameron. Mr. Phil, I saw you unmuted your mic earlier, and then Maurice.
Okay, so I agree with Shannon, and I also agree with James, but I'm gonna take it a little bit further with Jane, from what James said, because when you're in the valley is when you're at your lowest point. That's when you really don't know, when you're going through your trials and your tribulations a lot harder and a lot worse than you normally would. That's when, like Reggie said before, you know, that those bad influences, that's when those bad influences, you allow them to come into play, and you allow them to influence you. But when you get to that valley, and I'm gonna be transparent, with my life, I stayed in the valley a whole lot longer than I should have, because of trying to gain the love of somebody that to this day, I'm just now finding out why, but from that person, I never found out why. So I stayed in the valley way too long. So now, even though I'm not where I want to be in life, I'm actually going up that mountain to that peak. And even when I get to that peak, I'll still need somebody who's wiser than I am, who knows, still know, because there's going to be things that I'm still going to face that I'm not sure of, or I don't know and need to know. So again, you need both, because throughout life, you're still going to have your trials. You're still going to have your tribulations. You're going to be tested. And if you don't know how to get through them, which most times we don't, we need somebody who's either been there, or we need somebody who's been there and who knows how to get past or get out of what you're going through. So again, I say both, and like Shannon, I took part of the class before. I didn't take this part, so I'm glad I am starting from the beginning this time.
All right. Well, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Reggie, for the question about the peaks and the valleys, because it's bringing up a lot. When you are in that valley, you're dealing with valley people, valley mindsets, you're dealing with valley family, valley friends, and you do end up staying in the valley longer than expected. But it's when you get that, or it's when you keep looking up at that peak and you're like, man, there's something in me. There's something in me that's just saying that, like, this is not it. And you start looking up at that peak, be it you in a relationship and you looking at this relationship and you're like, man, this is just not it. You're in a career and you looking at the career and you're like, this is not it. You're wherever you are, the house you're in, the car you're in, you start looking at that peak. But sometimes you do need somebody to say, okay, if you want to get to that peak, you got some working out to do. Because you have to prepare your body for that trip. You have to prepare your mind for that trip. Miss Michelle said, I was meant for more and deserve better. That's when you start looking at that peak. So that's when it comes to that point where it's like, okay, I'm gonna need somebody to tell me how many push-ups and sit-ups I need to do and how many squats and whatever else, burpees. I don't like burpees, but this is the first thing that came to mind. How many burpees I'm gonna need to do to strengthen myself to start this journey up this peak. So thank you. Thank you very much, Miss Michelle. James, thank you. And Dr. Clark, thank you as always. Thank you very much. So now we're gonna move to Cameron. And then after Cameron, we have Mr. Phil. And after Phil, we have Maurice.
All right, thank you. So my first thought initially was the valleys, or where we would have the most opportunities to grow. And then I began to think on that. And I would agree with Dr. Shannon Clark there, the answer would be both. In that there are always teachable moments available to us. There's the recent passing of the country singer, and I just forgot his name. And they said that he was one of the most down-to-earth people you could ever meet. So whether he was in a peak or he was in a valley, he was always known for that part of his character. So what to maybe you and I to be a peak and a valley? He was able to smooth over by working on his humility, by working on his character, and seeing circumstances, seeing life, seeing other individuals as being teachable moments, and being able to grow through those different teachable moments, whether it be a peak or a valley. I'm near Kansas City, so I'm a big Chiefs fan, and so glad they won the Super Bowl. And one of the things that maybe is in this area is that I get to see where, Patrick Mahomes is spending time down in Texas, working out as if he had never won the Super Bowl. He's always constantly looking for that edge, constantly looking for those teachable moments. This man just won the Super Bowl, but yet he's still back working in the weight room, working on his technique. Because there's always those teachable moments. He's been in the valley, he's been in the peak, and yet he's still putting in the work. And that forms his character, that forms who he is. So to ultimately answer the question, I would say yes, both, to both the peak and the valley.
All right. Thank you, Cameron. Thank you very much. Now, you said something that I want to bring to everybody's attention real quick. He said that, and y'all, please, please forgive me for the football lovers. What was this gentleman's name again? The gentleman that Kara was just talking about, the football player.
Patrick Mahomes.
Patrick Mahomes. Okay, thank you. Y'all, please forgive me. I get talked about every time. Patrick Mahomes. Okay, I got it. He just said how Patrick Mahomes was at his peak. He won the Super Bowl. He was at his peak. And he went back to the valley. And he's working as though he was never on that peak. He's still working hard. He's still putting in the practice. So I want everyone to really think about this. How hard do you think you need to stay, you need to prepare while you're in your valley to stay on your peak longer? Because Cameron just laid that out real smooth. Patrick Mahomes won a Super Bowl. That's a peak. I don't know about anybody else, but that's a peak. But what did he, first off, what did he do in the valley to reach the peak? And then once he reached the peak, he went back to the valley to do more working out so he can go back and stay on his peak longer. So are you doing that same thing? While you're in your valley, are you working hard? Are you doing twice the work to stay in your valley so you can stay on your peak longer?
And I can give an example to that. There was a comedian from back in the day that after every performance, he would get on the empty stage and remind himself that that was in the past. And he essentially was like giving up everything about that past performance. So I would say it depends on the person and also on our ability to hold on to those thoughts, those feelings of how good it felt or how bad it may have felt. You know, we spoke about choice earlier and letting go of something. I would say it all depends on how quickly we are willing to let go of our thoughts, our feelings, our past relationships, and being able to move on from life.
All right. Thank you so much, Cameron. Thank you very much. So again, I want to thank Cameron, Michelle, James, and Dr. Clark for starting this off. Thank you, Dr. Clark. And James, Michelle, and Cameron, thank each of you for your input this evening. It is extremely valued. So thank you very much. And now we are going to move this over to Mr. Phil Sorrentino. The floor is now yours. And after Phil, Mr. Maurice.
The singer's name is Kenny Rogers.
Yes, sir. When I looked it up, that's the one that I had there.
The last thing Richard Nixon said as he stood in the White House lawn to get on the helicopter to leave the White House for the last time, he says, "You have to be in the lowest valley to appreciate the highest peak." Then he got on the helicopter and left the White House. My version of that is we're all yo-yos. Just some of us have longer strings than others. The key to life is shorten your string so your ups aren't so up and your downs aren't so down.
Thank you. Well, thank you, Mr.
Well said.
He comes on for a short period of time, but what he says has such power in it. So anytime Mr. Phil unmutes y'all, just make notes. Thank you so much, Mr. Phil. Thank you very much. So now we are going to open it up to Maurice. The floor is now yours.
Yeah, everything was said. I think Michelle G hit on what I wanted to say. So, but I just the part of, I looked up the word valley and it said an elongated depression between uplands, hills, and mountains. And when I first heard, you know, the question of whether being in the valley or in the peak, my first thought was to that when you're in the valley, you know, usually you're at the lowest point and it's easier to receive, it's more receptive when you're in the valley. But I'll now, after listening to all the comments that everyone said, I can see how both really relate, and that's real healthy. It seems like that's more of a healthy place when, you know, you can receive, because you're always in a teachable, should be in a teachable place at all times. I think it's more receptive in the valley. However, I would have to say both. But that's what I that's what I got from it. And I'm grateful for all the information and all the sharing. Thanks for allowing me to share that.
Oh, you're very welcome. Thank you, Maurice. Thank you very much. Each and every one of you, thank you so much. There's something Maurice said. When Maurice gave the definition of a valley, it sparked a question for me to ask each of you. How do you know which valley you are in? And I ask this question because not every mountain is the same height. So why would your valley be in the same place? When you look at all of your peaks and all of your valleys, how do you know that you're at the bottom? Like, how do you know that you're at the very valley that you started in, or you're in a valley in between peaks? So as you evaluate, as you're reading this book and as you evaluate your life, Antonio always tells us, you can only connect the dots going backwards. So you won't know what valley you're in until you look at where you are, look at where you've been, and connect the dots. So pay attention to your peaks and valleys. Now there's a part in the book that I want to read, because I want everyone's opinion on this, because sometimes we think once we get to a certain part in the peak, or even while we are in our when we're in our valley, we don't think our peaks and our valleys are connected. But while reading this, there's a part where the gentleman asks there's two gentlemen having a conversation. And he asked him, he said, as you were coming up, did you notice any break in the trail in between the valley and the peak? Like, did you notice that there was, you know, a complete break in the trail? And he was like, no. And then the young man took a second and he had to realize for himself. Your valley and your peaks are all connected. You can't get to your peak without your valley. So with the question that Reginald asked and with what everyone just said, how important is it for you to understand that everything is connected when it comes to your peaks and valleys? And
repeat the question again, please. Yeah.
How important is it for you to understand that everything is connected when it comes to your peaks and your valleys? Like, in order for you to even get to the peak, you have to go on a trail. But there is no division between the valley and the peak. Everything is connected. So how important is it? Go ahead, James.
So I'm going to use an example from someone else. There's a Pastor Michael Todd. Just this morning, I was listening to a sermon, and he goes, he was a drummer since he was born. Fast forward, his dad took him to play the drums, and he watched someone else get on his drums and do some cool stuff that he couldn't do on his own drums. And he said, I quit. I don't want to do this no more. He went to go cry to his grandma. Grandma told his dad. His dad said, come on, Michael, we're going to sign you up for a drum lesson. And he signs up for drum lessons. He gets there and he tells the master drummer, I'm not going to do this. I can't do this. And I won't do this. And the drummer goes, okay, then for the next year, you're not going to play the drums. You're going to play the pillow. So he put a pillow in front of him and had him do the same paradiddles on a pillow. 1-1, 1-1, 1-1, 2-2, all like left and right. Did that for a year. And he's like, you know, the whole time, for that whole year, he could just say, Dad, why are you paying this guy $40 an hour for me to play on a pillow? And fast forward some years later, he goes to a drum kit. That was his valley. He gets to the drum kit, and now he's like, all of that playing on the pillow for 1 year, which he hated, it makes so much sense. Because now it takes no effort and no sweat for him to, like, rip through the drums left and right, hit any paradiddle. He can do it like with his eyes closed. He can do it with no hands. And that's my way of saying, when you go through things at the bottom, it might not seem like it's what you want to do. It probably has nothing to do with what you want to do, but it's also the thing that's going to shape you to become who you need to be, or train you up in a way that this training will take care of you. And you might not realize it until the future that what you were doing then taught you a soft skill like patience, another soft skill like integrity, honesty, those things that aren't the hardcore like skills. So that's why I think it's the importance in it comes down to understand that what you're doing right now probably makes no sense at all. But it will make sense later when everything is on the other side of the coin.
All right. Thank you, James. Thank you very much. Thank you. Because that's how it's all connected. What you do in your valley, him beating on the pillows in his valley and him not understanding why allowed him to be on the peak and be able to run through the drums when he actually sat in front of a drum set. And so thank you very much, James. Thank you very much for your input and adding your value. And Ms. Cassandra said, life is not catered to one peak and one valley. One could be in a valley in one area of life and a peak in another part of life, thus creating a balance in life, not really realizing there is a valley or a peak. What I want you to think about is, everyone just close your eyes. Now imagine you are in your valley and you're looking up at the peak. And you begin to walk. You begin to walk and you begin to take your journey to the peak. Now, the more you walk, you notice that you're still kind of on flat land. You still notice that there hasn't been a change in the atmosphere. There hasn't been a change in the dirt under your feet. There hasn't been a change in the path that you're walking, but you keep walking. And as you walk, you realize you kind of start going up a little bit, just a little. And you notice that your valley is getting a little lower, but you haven't quite yet hit the beginning of the peak. So you keep walking and you keep walking. And then you realize that you've hit the beginning of the trail that takes you up to the peak. Now, while you're standing there, I want you to turn around and look. And I want you to understand that the highest point in your valley is the beginning of your peak. Now, what we have a tendency to do is stop at this point because we feel like we've reached a certain height. So we're like, yeah, you know, I'm higher than I was. But you didn't complete the journey. As you begin the as you begin your journey up the peak, I need you to understand that you will hit another valley. And when you hit that valley, when you keep walking and you notice how that valley starts going up, now you're at the highest point of that valley, which is the beginning of the peak. Like Ms. Cassandra said, life is not catered to one peak and one valley. Your life is full of peaks and valleys. It's just like a heartbeat. And every time you're in your valley, there's going to be somebody that's going to be presented to you or brought into your path to show you, like we, like the question was asked earlier, do you have coaches in both the valley and the peak? Yes. Because each valley is different. Each peak is different. And in order for you to stay on your valley long, stay on your peak longer, you have to train. You have to do the laps. You have to lift the weights. You have to do the studies. You have to read the books while you're in your valley so you can stay on your peak longer. And then when you get to that peak, what's to say that there's not another peak for you? So when you hit that peak, you're literally in the valley of your next peak. But they're all connected because the highest point in your valley is the beginning of your peak. There's never a break in the step. There's never a crater that you have to figure out how to get over. It's just another peak that you have to figure out how to get up. So my question to you is, what do you think you need to do in your current valley to even get to the beginning of your peak? And the floor is completely open.
Be grateful.
Embrace it. Face it. Confront it.
Trust in the process. Have that long-term goal already in mind.
The only moment in time that you own is right now. If you don't embrace that, you can't get to next.
Remember, those peaks and valleys are what made you who you are. So don't ever forget them. Get past them, get over them, but never forget them.
All right, I love it how y'all just wrote those out. Thank y'all. Gratitude. There was so much we had. Gratitude. Remember your peaks and valleys. There's only now. Please forgive me if I forgot something that someone said, but each and every one of you, embrace them. Thank you. Thank you, Grace. Embrace them. There is no way that you are going to be able to get up your peak if you don't do what all of you just said. But you also have to have a focus. If you lose sight of the peak, what is your focus? If you lose sight of where you're going, then you decide, you know what, that's a part of my character. I just don't feel like touching, so I'm going to stay where I'm at. Like Ms. Michelle said earlier, some people just don't want to change. But peaks and valleys, it's all about your growth in your character. It's all about, are you willing to have the humility and sacrifice what it is that you are to get to your focus, to get to where you want? There's no way that I would be able to be teaching this class tonight if I didn't have the humility to say, okay, years ago when I first started this class. Yeah, Deanna, you got some stuff you need to let go of. And then I was willing to make the sacrifice. I was willing to make the drive that it took. I was willing to make the sacrifice of sleep to stay up and read the books. The sacrifice of money to purchase the books. The sacrifice of time to sit in the classes. Only to learn that in the beginning I was arrogant because I thought I knew everything. So what is it that you, at this point in life, feel that in order for you to get to your next peak, what do you feel you need to sacrifice today? Now, if you choose to answer this question out loud, that is all up to you. Again, this is a safe place. But if it's something that you need to sit on and you need to think about, it's okay if you want to just write it down or journal it. Because personal sacrifice means a lot. And Mr. Reginald, please feel free to share your thoughts on what we have just talked about.
While we are away on Reggie, I'll be transparent and share what I need. And I needed it. I didn't approach the class arrogantly, but I approached it as, another round. And so I had an expectation, and I quickly had to release that expectation. And that was me looking at my peak and going back down, connecting my dots to a valley moment. And I remember it is either two or three classes ago, my only goal in this class was to be open. And just like a movie, it was like, okay, this is it. There is nobody in this class that I can't learn from. I have to release my student brain, because if I show up in one of my doctoral classes and I haven't read, I'm lost. So of course, to be prepared for today, I read my three chapters, I'm ready to go, but I had to remember that's not how this class works. But my school brain was on, and so I had to quickly just go back through what platform I'm on and how there is a need for me to be here, because I wouldn't be here if I didn't know that there was something that was going to happen in this course that was going to help me reach a peak. I'm in the middle in a few things in my life. I'm charting my way up, and I'm not up there yet. And so sometimes you have to go back to what got you to another peak, because anybody that has taken this entire class before, you start low, but you end high. Mad, pissed off, all of that, but you feel higher than what you started. So just in a moment of transparency, I had to release some of my own sacrifice, my own expectation, and embrace what you and Reginald are doing a great job with. And that came from knowing, be open, not arrogant, and not overly expectant. And something else, I'm gonna just throw this out there. You have to, at some point, let go of your need to be right. You have to let go of your need to be right. There's nobody in here that you can't learn from, and there's nobody in this room and on this platform that knows everything. And so that was what I had to do to realize what I needed to get to the valley. I had to let go of my own expectations and allow leaders to lead and realize that there's a lot to be learned from every single person present here. And Shannon don't know everything, and neither does anybody else in here. So I'm just enjoying this class today, and I'm very proud of you, Deanna, and I'm very proud of Reggie. So I'm done.
Thank you. Thank you.
I like to add, if I could, ego.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
I like to add ego, and because that is, you know, I tell students all the time, you know, one of the first things I say is, you know, hey, this class is going to be a lot easier, you know, if we just check at the door and just leave, you know, what you know, what you think you know. And speaking, and I tend to not do it enough myself, and that's information that I give, but to check the ego and to remind myself to be forever a student and to be in present time. Because if I'm in present time and present, you know, with where we are right now, this moment, what we're talking about, and, you know, not today, not in the last conversation I was in, but right here at this moment in present time, then it's easy for me to be able to say, okay, I'm a student. You know, I'm not the instructor. I'm not the teacher. I don't know. You know, I don't know. And it's okay not to know, and to be okay with not knowing, because there are going to be some things that I do know. And so, you know, at some point. So I think it's ego that gets in the way of that, that makes it that. So just ego, I would say, and to be in present time. That's what I like to share about that part of it. Yep.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Maurice. Thank you, Dr. Clark. This may be, what's the word I'm looking for? Not unprecedented, but unorthodoxical. That's probably not a word.
I would have definitely used that word. That would have been a word in my dictionary.
Thank you.
I sure would have used it.
Appreciate
you. Use it well.
Yes, sir, I will. Yeah. This may be unorthodoxical.
There you go.
I'm going to be transparent as well. I had to sacrifice the same way coming into this. Because mind you, I've only been a student in this for the last 3 years. I've never taught it. And Antonio always teaches us, when you do something, be yourself. So I had to release my own expectancy of this course in order for me to be able to teach it. I had to release, okay, Antonio did it this way. He did it that way. He did it this way. This is the structure he had. This is how he did it. This is how Tempest structured this. And this is how she stood. Like, I literally had to, in the beginning of the class, like when we first started, I literally had to say, okay, Deanna, just chill. Like, so we all have sacrifices that, thank you, Shannon. Because like when you were talking, that's what I was like, okay, she's talking to me. She had to do the same thing I had to do. We all have things that we have to sacrifice. You know, we all have thought processes in order for us to reach peaks, because I can guarantee you, thank you Miss Lisa, thank you very much, and thank you, Vaseen, as well. I can guarantee you by the end of this course I will be on a peak, but I had to start in my valley, and in order for me to even begin, I literally had to sacrifice my own mindset just to teach. So I want y'all to take that and apply it to your relationships, apply it to your parenting, apply it to your friendships, apply it to everything that you do. Because going into anything, you have to release some things in order for you to be able to just teach somebody else. When you go into being a teacher in school, the only concept you have in your head is what your teachers did, but you're not your teachers. When you have kids, the only idea of parenting that you have in your head is what your parents did, but you are not your parents. When it comes to relationships, marriages, the only ideas that you have are the examples of those before you, but you are not them. So there are going to be points in time where you are going to have to sacrifice your own mindset in order to grow. You're going to have to sacrifice who you are in order to become who you want to be. And it's not easy, because sometimes it's so stuck in you. Antonio always tells us what's alive is going to fight before it dies. you literally have to sacrifice something is to kill it. Okay, Miss Michelle, to sacrifice something means to literally kill it. Sacrifice back in the days meant to kill something. So you literally have to kill something in you and replace it with where you want to go. So I want to thank Shannon for her transparency. Maurice, thank you for your transparency, because ego does play a big part in it. Ego plays a huge part in it, because if you are not willing to release the arrogance and say, I don't know anything, you will not learn. And you will always stay where you are. You will always be in your valley. You will never make it to your peak, because you're going to be too stuck where you are.
Exactly.
So go ahead, Reginald. The floor is yours.
Last but not least, me personally, I like the hard way. I did this class before. I sit back just like I did tonight. Observe. Constructive criticism, I've taken that my whole life. I have no problem with that whatsoever. I filter what I need and what I don't need. I'm not taking it in. And I'm going to just roll with it. But I love, there's one thing I was thinking about while we was having this whole conversation is, as crazy as it might sound, I actually like the valley. I like dancing through the valley, because I feel like the valley people need a spokesman. My whole life I felt like that. Yeah, everybody's goal is to get to the top and be at the top, but you know what? It's lonely at the top. Very lonely at the top. I've learned so much. I love learning the hard way. Excuse me, y'all, but that's just me. I love learning the hard way, because I can strip of that prideful self. I can strip off all that stuff that I don't need, take that off, and go to the next step. And look, and I don't even want to turn around and look back at that old, like a snake. A snake don't go back and go look at his skin and be like, look at that skin I just shed. Snake does not do that whatsoever. But again, I've appreciated everybody in the comments, everybody that had something to say. I'm looking forward to the future of this class, and continue to build off each other and continue to learn and add value to each other. That's all I would like to add.
All right, Mr. Reginald. I want to share something that Antonio has shared with us a few different times, and it's going off of what Reginald just said. Antonio's told us so many times, I am the most lonely person because I'm at the top. He said, everyone quits on me, but I'm never allowed to quit. When you're on the top, like Reginald said, it's lonely at the top. But when you go back to the valley, that's when you teach people. That's when you coach them. Because as you go up the top, at some point, they're going to get there too, if they actually decide to make the character change. Antonio is at the top, but do you realize how many times he's come back down to the valley for us? How many times have you gone back down to the valley for someone? Think about it. You made it. You got out. But you went back because you knew, you realized, you learned how to do it. You taught yourself how to do it, but you knew there were others who did not know. And you wanted to go back and help them. You wanted to help them through whatever mental crisis they were going through. You wanted to help them through whatever emotional crisis they were going through. You wanted to help them through whatever it was that they're going through, because you've been there. You got through that valley and you made it to your peak. That's when it comes to, do you have coaches in both your valley and your peak? And as Dr. Shannon R. Clark said earlier, yes. And the reasoning is, you've learned. And you have to go back to the valley to gather more resources so you can make it to your peak. But while you're down there, you're coaching others to prepare them for the peak as well. For Antonio, the valley is where he got his knowledge and his strength. There is nothing on the peak but prosperity, but you need strength to maintain the prosperity of the peak. And you can only get that in the valley. And I'm gonna repeat it. The valley is where Antonio got his knowledge and his strength. There's nothing on the peak but prosperity, but you need strength to maintain the prosperity of the peak, and you can only get that in the valley. It goes back to what it's the same thing Cameron was saying earlier about Patrick Mahomes. It's the same thing Cameron was saying about Patrick Mahomes. He hit prosperity when he won the Super Bowl. That was his peak. But all the time he spent practicing, working out, studying plays, that he did in his valley. He gained his strength. He gained his endurance. He gained everything he needed in the valley so that he can make it to the peak. At the end of it all, your valley is your workout space. Your valley is your study grounds. Your valley is your library. Your valley is the place where you gather all the knowledge you need to learn how to get up the peak, what to do when you get on the peak, and how to stay on the peak longer. But you're going to have to come back down to that valley. Because again, everything is connected. There's no crater between the end of the valley and the beginning of the peak. There is no crater. The highest level of your peak is the highest level of your valley is the bottom of your peak. And there are multiple peaks and there are multiple valleys. You just need to know which one you're in. Don't want to mingle with the top. I want to bring the top to the valley. That was Ms. Lisa. So before we end this evening, please express open floor. What have you gotten out of this evening? What is your focus? Where do you think you are in your valley? Are you on the trail to your peak? Are you on the trail to your peak? Or again, like I said earlier, what is it that you think you need to sacrifice so that you can continue your journey? Trust the process. That's what Cameron said earlier. He said, trust the process. So what is it that you feel you need to sacrifice? What part are you in the middle of your valley making it through? Are you at the peak? Are you at the peak of your valley and the beginning of your peak? And the floor is open. Go ahead.
I think with all what's going on right now, with knowing that we're going to be facing a new normal and going to be facing something and being faced with something like we've never been faced with before. And, you know, accepting and being here, I think for me, it's the beginning of the valley. And to the depth of your valley really determines the height of your peak. So, you know, so for me, I'm going to say that I would say the beginning of the valley of a for this time and space, you know, for this space and this reality that we're faced with, that I'm faced with, that, you know, each individual is faced with. And it's different for everybody. You know, everyone has their own, it's different for everyone. So to speak for myself, for me being in, you know, I would say at the beginning of the valley. And, you know, and like so many have said, you know, it's actually comfortable. You know, there's comfort in the valley, you know, because that's where all the characters built. That's where, you know, it's in that place, and it's in that often dark space. It's in that place because not only is, you know, the presence of the higher power for me is present there, you know. For me, that's a comfort place, and, you know, that's what, you know, I've gotten my best out of those peaks. I mean, those are valleys, because there's different times and different phases of valleys. You know, at my lowest point when I was incarcerated, and when I was in that belly and in that cell, I can remember it like it was yesterday. And when I made that cry out to ask, you know, whatever your will is, let it be mine. And that whatever it is that, you know, that really was a turning point to help to get to a peak for me. So I think that, you know, at a peak, so that's what valleys do. So it's a comforting place to be at the beginning of a valley, and to be in a place of, because it really determines the altitude, you know, the heights. And I can see it, you know, so, you know, I can see, you know, see the other side of it, the end of it, you know, the height of it. That's what that means for me, for the people. That's where I'm at with it. So.
All right. Thank you so very much for sharing, Maurice. We greatly appreciate your transparency and the value that you have added to this call this entire evening. So thank you very much. I do agree with you when you say, with everything going on today, we are in a valley. But at the same time, what part of the valley are we in? Is it just the middle of the valley? Is it the beginning of the valley? Is it the end of the valley? That's up to you to determine. But we are moving into it. We are moving into a new type of normal. And it's going to be scary at first. But now it all determines what you're going to do while you're in this valley to get to your next peak. Middle mayhem for I feel the need to reiterate this. There are several peaks and there are several valleys. When you started this class, you're in a certain valley. But before you even got here, you had already hit a peak. And then you're on that valley. And then you hit another peak. And now you're in that valley. Then you hit another peak and you're in that valley. Because you had to grow up. However, whatever age you are at, you've already gone through peaks and valleys. As a newborn, you were in a valley. You didn't know how to crawl. You didn't know how to walk. You didn't know how to speak. You didn't know how to take care of yourself. By the time you hit one, you've already been through a valley and hit a peak, because you learn how to crawl. You learn how to stand. You learn how to keep your balance while you're standing. And then you took your first steps. So your entire life is full of peaks and valleys. It's what you do in the valley that helps you get to your next peak. And Reginald, I have to admit, when you said, how did you phrase it? Dancing through the valley. I love how you said that, because you love dancing through the valley, you pull so many people to you that you're able to walk them to their next peak. Because dancing is joy. Dancing is happiness. There, some people find peace in dancing. So to each and every one of you, what is your form of dance? What is your form of dance while you're in the valley? Find your form of dance so you can learn and grow while you're in your valley. So now I'm going to pass it over to Mr. Reginald Paul. The floor is yours. Go ahead and close us out.
Well, I hope everybody enjoyed the class. We'll see you again until the next appointed time. So I've never closed anything out except for a basketball game or something like that. But I guess that's how it's supposed to go. Good evening. Good night. Yeah, I tried.
Thank you. Do you have any closing thoughts for us?
I don't have no closing thoughts.
All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us for the first Integrity Leadership class. We will see you next Thursday, same time, same place. If you need the audiobook, reach out to any of us so we can send it over to you. This is the book itself, Peaks and Valleys. And next week, we are going to be reading chapters, we will be reading chapters 4, 5, and 6. Thank you all so much for joining us. In the words of our CEO, you can plan better. You can dominate. Good night, everyone.
Good night, Deanna. Good night, Don.
Good night.
Peace out, everybody. All right. Love you guys.
Thank y'all. Good night.
You should really be famous for every tear you've ever cried, for everything that's ever happened to you. For all the abuse you've ever been through, for the divorce you've ever been through, you should absolutely be famous for that. Yeah, that's how I think. As a matter of fact, that's how most of us great motivational speakers or platform speakers, we are. I speak over 400 times a year. I command over $40,000 a keynote. $40,000 a keynote. I can make $30,000 in 30 minutes. All because my story was one of tragedy, and I've learned how to take it to one of great wealth. I want to teach you that. I want to give to you free, no risk, no charge, no credit card needed. Free 20 hours of how to get famous for telling your story. Antonio T. Smith Jr., you can plan better. You can dominate. I have failed so much in life. I've been so evil. I've done everything in life to mess it up, and I have. I have completely messed this life up. And then I changed. And then I started applying things that I didn't know, but I always knew. You call it the law of attraction. Or maybe you don't. Or maybe you're religious and maybe you're not. Here is what I know. I know that we all have a karmic debt to pay off. And I have either paid mine off or almost off. And now I dedicate my entire life to you. Please know that as my life is dedicated to you, it means I get beat up a lot. But that's what this is about. It's about people like me putting their gains at risk for you. The crazy thing about life is once we get enough, whatever enough means, you're a politician, it's enough votes, someone likes money, enough money, whatever enough is, you're a pastor, enough members, we tend to protect them. This podcast is not about protection, it is about you. I want you to share this podcast, but not for personal gain. I want to share it because I'm giving you my every being. So you can turn around and say it for others.
give away me, and then you give away you. I lower me so you can stand on my shoulders. Finally, the music in this podcast that you're going to hear, I hope it gets stuck in your head. It's actually from my favorite movie, Cloud Atlas. It's a cover. It's not the original version, but it sounds just like it. Cloud Atlas is a great movie by the Wachowskis. My second favorite movie is Matrix, but that's not the first. It is about repeating the same states in some open subconsciously. That as you repeat the same mistakes, while that is mostly about ascending those mistakes. So I'm hoping the words, music, everything helps you ascend to where you're supposed to be, which is. This is the secret to success and law of attraction. I really, really know that this will be a blessing, a lifesaver to many people. Antonio T. Smith Jr., you can't plan better. You can dominate.